And the guests that he brought really reminded all of us about what is best in America and what is best in all of us. It was a very moving speech. I've been to many states of the Union, as have my colleagues, and this was among the very, very best. It was a really, really special speech. In stark contrast to that, Speaker Pelosi had a tantrum. She disgraced herself. She dishonored the House. She showed once again that she is an embarrassment, that she is unfit for office. And the American people are going to have an opportunity to make that decision to choose between two visions for the future of this country in November. The contrast couldn't be clearer. The difference between a president who has delivered on his promises, a president who's done what he said he was going to do, a president who has yielded an era of unmatched economic growth, who is rebuilding our military, who's keeping this nation safe, and a party that you saw last night so blinded by anger, so blinded by hatred of this president, that they wouldn't even applaud the most basic common things, common decency, applaud a young girl who's getting a scholarship to go to school, applaud, in some cases, some of them wouldn't even applaud the Tuskegee Airmen. It was a really disgraceful show, and I think that the speaker capped it all off at the end of the speech. But the American people deserve better. The American people are going to get better, and we feel very, very confident that come November they're going to make the right decision. And Speaker Pelosi's term as Speaker of the House will not go beyond this year. With that, I would like to turn things over to the gentleman from Louisiana, a member of the House Judiciary Committee, and someone who has been on the President's defense team over in the Senate, to talk about what's happening in the Senate, Mr. Johnson from Louisiana.
Thank you, Liz. Just one comment briefly about last night. The theme of the speech I thought was so appropriate, the Great American Comeback Story. That's exactly what it is that we're celebrating. And I was had an aisle seat last night and tapped the president on the shoulder on the way out and told him that I thought the speech was Reagan-esque. It was optimistic. It struck exactly the right tone. And I think it's exactly what the country needed. And as Liz said, by stark contrast, can I be honest with you and tell you, I was just kind of brokenhearted, honestly. I was on the aisle on the left side of the chamber, so I was almost on the Democrat side because we had an overflow, and I was seated so close to my colleagues, and I have a lot of friends, we all do, on the Democrat side, and to me, just to look out and see that there's so many Democrats in Congress today that are unwilling to stand for America literally and figuratively, and it is just a very sad moment, I think, for the country, and Pelosi's antics were just the icing on the cake, and I think the American people see that for what it is, and there'll be a reckoning for it. Today, we will finally get the full acquittal of President Donald J. Trump of this impeachment charade, the sham. We've run out of ways to describe it, but I think the people back home see it for what it is, and I think the U.S. Senate does as well. We've been very pleased with how the defense team handled the case and put on the facts and the law, the evidence, which is all on the side of the president and always has been. And today, we expect a bipartisan acquittal. No one knows the final vote tally yet, but we expect that at least two, maybe three Democrats will come across the aisle and do the right thing and vote to acquit the president. And as we've said all along, the lasting effect of this, and people say, what comes next? What does this mean for the future? The great concern that all of us have is the Pandora's box that's been opened, because the Democrats have decided for the first time in our history, remember, we're 243 years into this constitutional republic, this experiment in self-governance. The founders warned us, hey, that impeachment clause of the Constitution, Article 2, Section 4, is only to be very rarely used. And please, they warned us, in common parlance, what I would say today, please don't ever weaponize that impeachment provision. Because if you do that, it will put the country on a dark road. If you have a single-party impeachment that is used as a way to exact a political vendetta, that takes us down a very scary path. And that's where we are now. They have taken the very high burden for impeachment and trampled it underfoot. And so now every president from now on has to be looking over their shoulder to see if that trigger is going to be pulled on them. And that is what our ultimate concern is at the end of the day. But finally, we'll get behind this. We'll get beyond it. And I think the American people are ready for that. I'll turn it over to our whip, Steve Scalise.
Thank you, Mike. Thanks for your leadership with all of our other colleagues that have been representing the president so well in this impeachment, this political vendetta that it clearly has been from the beginning. I'm glad it's going to finally end today, and it's going to end in acquittal. It'll be the only the second time in our country's history where a majority of senators voted for acquittal because they recognize there was no crime. Every other impeachment started with a crime and then went through to see if it was removable. In this case, there was never a crime. There was the hope by Speaker Pelosi and all of the radical socialist Democrats who started this to try to find something. And they never did, and yet they still put the country through this. And it's a shame that they did it. There were so many really important issues that we could have come together on, things that the president talked about last night, like lowering prescription drug prices, where we came together, Republicans and Democrats, to pass a package of bills out of committee to lower drug prices, and it came out unanimously. The president would have signed that package, but the speaker won't bring those kind of bipartisan bills to the floor because she has been so fixated with her own power with impeaching the president because she disagrees with the results of the 2016 election, and she's scared to death that this president will win again. And frankly, the president showed last night why he's got such a strong case to make to the nation to get reelected for another 4 years because of what he's done to deliver on the promises that he made in 2016. And now it's working for families across this country. The theme was the Great American Comeback. And the president gave this optimistic view of what's happening in the country, not for people in Washington and for their power, but how he's empowered people across this country, how he has fought for those forgotten men and women of this country who were left behind by Washington for so long. He's delivering for families who want a chance at the American dream, and that chance at the American dream has never been stronger for people all across this nation in every sector. Whether it's the lowest unemployment for African Americans, for Hispanics, women-owned businesses are up. And what did the Democrats do? Do they applaud other people's success? No, they sit down. I thought it was so telling that when we're applauding the success of hardworking families across the country, they're sitting down. If it doesn't mean government's not the reason that you're being successful, you're successful because you've actually gone and reached out for your own piece of the American dream. They don't applaud that. I thought it was disgraceful what Speaker Pelosi did last night to rip up the speech. It wasn't just President Trump's speech. It was the names of those military servicemen and women, people who have given their life for our country. She ripped their names up. The Tuskegee Airman, who was recognized as a general, she ripped his name up. The country was watching. It was unbecoming of a Speaker of the House to act that way. And if this is where their party is, I mean, look, they can't even count votes in an election. They're still literally trying to figure out, and maybe they already know, but the fact that they couldn't even get that right in Iowa. Look, their first bill, H.R. 1, tells you a lot about what their priorities are. When we were in the majority and Donald Trump was president, our first bill, our H.R. 1, number one priority, was the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, a bill that's still working for families all across the country, the bill that created the greatest economy that President Trump touted. Do you know their H.R. 1 is a bill to federalize elections, to literally do for the country what they did on the Democrat side in Iowa, a party that's so incompetent they can't even create an app to count less than 200,000 votes. And so I think when you look at this contrast, the president had a great story to tell last night about America, not about power in Washington, but about how giving people their own ability to have the American dream is working for families across this country. And Speaker Pelosi showed why they are unfit to be in charge. It's why we're going to get the majority back with another 4 years of Donald Trump as our president. And leading our charge is our leader here in the House on the Republican side, Kevin McCarthy. I'd like to introduce him.
Thank you, Steve. Good morning. Last night, what we heard was not a Republican or a Democrat speech. It was an American one. And when I sat and listened to it, just as I listened to others before, when there were things I agreed with, I stood. But when I watched the Democrats sit and talk about, when the president spoke about what the hopes of America's dreams, but the comeback from this country, it was appalling. When I watched Nancy Pelosi tear up a speech, she cannot tear up the dreams of a 13-year-old great-grandson of Charles McGee, who watched his grandfather fight against all odds just because of the color of his skin to defend our nation and fly. But with a more perfect union that he can dream of going to space. Or a soldier returning home to his family, defending our rights and our freedom. Or a single mother who is just like any of us, who would give up anything for a better future for her daughter, got to hear that she got an opportunity scholarship. This is not partisanship. This is what really brings us together. It's what entwines us as Americans, that tomorrow will be better than today. 3 years ago, we could not imagine that this economy would be this strong, that America would lead again. But could you only imagine what the next 30 years would be if we had a Congress that wasn't partisan, that actually worked for the best of what America could be? You know, when I sat and listened to the president, I never heard him one time mention impeachment. But when I listened to the Democrat rebuttal, that's where I heard the word. I guess it shows that the partisanship is really driven on one side. Today, the president will be acquitted for life. I hope the Democrats will finally end their desire to impeach this president. I know it's been joining us today, but more importantly, I want to thank Mike for his work when it came to the impeachment, for his work for being able to get the truth out. And as we end this nightmare today, let us pledge, whoever is in power in Congress, that we never weaponize impeachment again, sheerly for your politics and animosity that was displayed by the speaker last night. Questions? Yes, sir.
If the president won't shake the speaker's hand and the speaker tears up the president's speech, are you okay with that going forward, or is there a remedy? I know the president doesn't drink. Is it time for a beer summit or something to put them together and end this, or are you okay with it?
I don't think those two are the same. I don't even know if the president saw the speaker's hand. I saw him give her the paper, turn around, but to equate those two is fundamentally different. The speaker, who was given an official document, who chose to tear up Charles McGee's great-grandson's dream, or a soldier returning home, I think if somebody needs to sit down and change, it comes to the speaker. And I think the actions of wasting a majority, the promise that she made to America, that they would be different, they look to govern together, they believe the minority should have a voice, we've seen none of that. Yes, I think the country is too divided right now. But for that same moment in time, you have a president just with the, if you look at one contrast, signing a United States-Mexico-Canada agreement with China, trying to bring Middle East, all the while we had House managers on the other side working on impeachment. The only Democrats that had reserved seating were the House managers. That's what they wanted to highlight with their achievements, if there was a message to the American public of what a majority in the House with the Democrats were able to give, House managers. I think they need to have a wake-up call, yes. Yes, sir.
Thank you. We understand from the Democratic caucus that the speaker told them this morning that she was looking for a page in the speech that didn't have a lie in it, and when she didn't find it, she tore up the page, which wound up being all the pages of the speech. What is your reaction to that?
Was it a lie that a young mother, single mother, dreamt for her child to go to a better school? Was it a lie that a 13-year-old great-grandson dreamt of going to space because of what his great-grandfather was able to achieve in America? Was it a lie that the policies of a sanctuary city, that there were four brothers missing Rocky, their oldest brother? Was it a lie that this is the greatest economy we've watched in our lifetime? Was it a lie that this is a blue-collar boom? Or was the only lie that they had nothing to do with it, that they were so driven on impeachment, that that was their only agenda? The president never mentioned it. The president only talked about America, what we've been able to achieve and what we could achieve in the future. It's very sad that a person in that position, next in line to the presidency after the vice president, would one tear up a speech in a country that believes in the right of free speech, and in a position as speaker to behave in that manner. I don't know of any other speaker that ever acted that way, let alone I don't know any other Congress that has ever moved a pure partisan impeachment that was the thinnest, the fastest, and pure politics on every stretch.
Yes, sir.
So last year,
what's that?
Looking good. Last year, the speaker clapped back at the president, and that got a lot of, press. And then October 16th, you know, she wagged her finger at the president, I believe in the cabinet room. And now last night we have the optics of her tearing up the speech. Where do you think this goes from here now? I mean, we've had 134 days of an impeachment trial. Do you think that there's any possibility that Congress can move forward on legislative business in the next year? Or is this all going to be just campaign mode from the rest of this point on?
You know, in Congress, 218 is the power of Congress. That's when you become speaker. That's when you control the rules. There's not one thing that you mentioned about the highlights of Speaker Pelosi that was a legislative achievement. You only mentioned personal actions. That would be a terrible legacy. The only person who can determine that is the person that determined that she tore up a speech. The same person that determined we were going to move into impeachment without having a vote of the House. The same person who selected chairs of their committees based upon whether they'd be best to impeach the president. I think their past behavior is the best indication of a future behavior. So the question is really to the American public. Do they want more of the same, or would they like a Congress that would work with them? Across the aisle, that would put America first instead of blaming America first. I think that's the question come November. And I think, reading the latest polls, I think America's waking up to the lies of this new majority and the wasted time that they have had at their job. Thank you very much.